Are you seeing a lot of aides in your practice?
Not a lot, okay, but I do good. See it.
You do?
Yeah, and it's alarming when I do see it.
Right.
Because, you know, we do a lot of, when we see women, especially women who are in their first trimester coming from for prenatal care, we see them and we do prenatal labs on them.
Uh-huh.
And part of the prenatal lab profile is mm-hmm. to do an HIV test, to do syphilis tests,
right.
test for gonorrhea and chlamydia.
Right.
And sometimes we see women come back with a positive HIV. It's not rare,
yeah.
but it's not uncommon
it
to see
happens.
It. It does happen. And
Are they totally surprised when it happens?
Most of the time they are, yeah.
Really?
Yeah, and it's very, very difficult to sit down and tell someone that you have HIV or, you know, even to tell them that they have chlamydia and gonorrhea, because that has a lot of implications.
Oh, really?
For their relationship. And so,
right.
you know, so if they have gonorrhea and chlamydia, that means that somebody is not being faithful.
You said some of your patients have AIDS, some of the pregnant patients.
Mm-hmm.
How do they cope with the disease in pregnant?
Now, that's a good question. You know, how does anyone cope with the disease?
Yeah.
You know, whether they're pregnant or not, you know, when people are diagnosed with any kind of disorder,
uh-huh.
it has an effect on them mentally, and I'm sure that some people get depressed.
Yeah.
And it's difficult for people that are pregnant, people that are not pregnant, to deal with AIDS.
Right.
And so I think one of the most important things to do when you initially find out that you have HIV is to seek a physician that specializes in HIV, so you can get all the correct information.
Okay.
You can be put on all of the newest medications that they have.
Okay.
And so a way to cope with HIV is to seek medical care immediately.
Okay.
And to seek specialized medical care immediately,
right.
and to rely on what people are saying in the streets, and know what the real treatment is out there for you.
Right.
But you know, even if you do that, it's very difficult. You know, and one of the worst things to do is to be in a state of denial.
A woman who's pregnant with AIDS, can she have a healthy child?
Yes.
Oh, really?
Yes. Yes. So, and that's why it's important. So, if I have a woman comes in to see me who has HIV,
right,
or who I the diagnosis of HIV, I send them to a specialist who deals with HIV.
Oh,
and usually I'll start them on some medications for HIV during their pregnancy.
Okay.
And when they deliver, we start them on AZT during their delivery through the IV. For the baby, really.
Okay.
That's for the baby. So they'll be on medications for them
right.
During the pregnancy, and during the delivery, we would give them AZT, which is a HIV medication, through the IV for the baby. So, yes, women who are HIV positive can have a healthy baby, meaning a baby without HIV.
Tell us about HPV.
HPV is human papillomavirus, which is... it's been in the news a lot lately.
Right.
And it is the virus that is linked to cervical cancer.
Right.
And also it's linked to genital warts, abnormal pap smears.
Okay.
And usually people who have HPV, the virus will infect the cells of their cervix. And they can transform these cells and make them abnormal and or dysplastic, or meaning bad cells. Dysplasia means bad cells.
Uh-huh.
These bad cells or dysplastic cells can, over a long period of time, go to cancer,
right.
cervical cancer. That's why they say people that have HPV, human papillomavirus, cells get infected on the cervix, become abnormal or dysplastic, can go to cancer. So that's why they say HPV will lead to cancer.
Oh,
now, HPV is transferred, it's like a skin virus.
Really?
Yeah, it's a skin virus. And what happens is the virus, in order for the virus to get to the cervix, it has to have a way to get to the cervix.
Mm-hmm.
And so in order to get to the cervix, it has to have a transport. And usually that transport is during sex.
Oh.
And so that's why some people say that HPV is a type of sexually transmitted disease.
Oh.
But it's usually from skin-to-skin contact.
Well, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Well, what is the controversy around the shot, you know, to prevent it?
Well, yeah. The shot, the Gardasil shot, that's what you're talking about,
yes.
Right? The Gardasil shot is a series shot that is over three series that is used to prevent people from not being exposed to it, but if they are exposed to it, their body, it's like a vaccine. It is a vaccine.
Right.
They prevent them from contracting the HPV virus.
Okay.
And so usually it was developed for women from 9 to 26 years of age.
9 years old?
Yes.
Why so young?
Well, they're trying to catch people before they get exposed to the virus.
Wow.
And so statistics show that by the age 50, 80% of people have already been exposed to the HPV virus.
Really?
Yeah.
80%? They've been exposed, but they haven't been infected.
Well, they may have been infected but fought it off. So that's how we knew that we could develop a vaccine. We know that a lot of people are exposed to the virus, but they don't get cervical cancer. They don't get abnormal cells. And so we know that our body can fight it off and we can build up immunity against it. And
okay.
So that's how they developed the vaccine.
Okay.
Well, knowing this fact that a lot of people have been exposed to it but don't have it. But some people are exposed to it but have it. So what we want to do is give people the vaccine before they're exposed to the virus so they can build up an immunity and so that hopefully one day we can eradicate cervical cancer.
Oh, yeah, that's right. You know, I have heard people say that it's so new till they're kind of afraid
they're
to give
afraid,
it to
yeah.
their young girls. What do you think about that?
Well, you know, there's a lot of research done on it, and you know, I give it to young ladies that come to my office that request it, and I counsel people on it because you know it's a lot of people that die from cervical cancer.
Oh, my goodness!
And so, you know, you have to weigh the risk and the benefits. Is you know, what is the risk of giving this vaccine?
Okay.
And you know, other than some people have allergic reactions.
Oh, really? What type of allergic reaction?
Well, you know, just like any medication you take, you can have allergic reaction to. You
okay.
know, if you get a shot of antibiotic, you can get a rash, or you have shortness of breath, or you can be allergic to some of the material that's in the vaccine.
I mean, what are the warning signs of cervical cancer?
Well, to be honest with you, there are not many warning signs of cervical cancer.
Really?
However, there's a test that we do on women every year that can give us an idea whether they're at risk.
Oh, really?
Do you know what that test is?
Well, Pap smear?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, the Pap smear is the test that we do. And the Pap smear will show whether there are abnormal cells on the cervix.
Okay.
And those, as I talked to you earlier, if you have the HPV virus, then they will infect your cells on your cervix. And then when you come in for your yearly exam, we do a Pap smear and we get the discharge from your vagina, and we send that to a pathologist. He looks at the cells and say these cells look normal or abnormal.
Right. Okay.
And so those, when we get that back, we'll bring the patient in. We'll look at her cervix.
Okay.
Under closely and to see if there's any evidence of cancer. So that's one warning sign that we can, and that's very important, and that's why it's so important for women to get yearly exams.
What is it like being the only African American on the Mississippi Supreme Court?
Well, being a Supreme Court Justice, African American or not, is an awesome responsibility because we have, I think, an obligation to try and ensure that the people whose cases appear before that court ultimately receive justice. And so that responsibility in and of itself, irrespective of race, is just an awesome responsibility. When you add the overlay of the fact that I happen to be the only African-American on the court, I mean, I think that holds some significance. I certainly am a product of my background, my environment, my upbringing, and so I hope that what I bring to bear on my decision-making is at least in part influenced by who I am, the way I was raised, and what that upbringing is. And, of course, that includes the undeniable fact that I'm an African-American.
Okay. What is your favorite part of the job?
That is difficult to say. I think the favorite part of the job probably really is reading the research, learning new things, discovering new things. It is still exciting to me to learn, to read, to learn, to discover something brand new, to learn about an area of the law that I may not have known about before, to come across or encounter an issue that's novel, that's new, that I haven't explored before. Those kinds of things are exciting.
What is the most challenging part of the job?
Most challenging for me, considering that I was a trial judge for 10 years before becoming an appellate judge, where as a trial judge, I didn't have to consult with anybody, I didn't have to check with anyone else, I didn't have to get anyone else's agreement in order to make a ruling. And so probably the most challenging part for me is dealing with the dynamic of being an appellate judge on a 9-member court where you have to have at least 4 other people agree with you in order to constitute a majority opinion on that court. And so you have to recognize that there's just a different dynamic at work in order to reach a decision in an environment like that.
As you know, there are a lot of judge TV shows. Do you think citizens can learn a lot from watching those shows?
TV judge shows are entertainment. I mean, television, for the most part, is about entertainment. There is some educational TV, but the TV judge shows are not found on educational television channels. They're found on entertainment channels. Yeah. And so they really are entertainment, and I think while I don't have a problem with people viewing those shows for entertainment purposes, there is a disservice which is done by those shows to the extent that people think that that's what court is really like. And so somebody who watches Judge Joe Brown every day for 2 months now thinks they know a lot about the law and how cases are supposed to go, and you really don't. You know a lot about how things go on Judge Joe Brown's show. But those shows are probably more unlike what real court is than they are like the way real court is. And so I think people can come away with a very, very skewed view of what court is really like. And then they're coming away with some sense that they really know how the courts work, or what the justice system is like. I don't know how much of a service they do in that regard.
Yes.
They can be very entertaining, I imagine.
Exactly. Well, where did you go to law school?
Went to law school in New York at Syracuse University.
Okay, so what was it like going to law school at Syracuse?
It was very, very different from being in Mississippi. It's the northeast region of the country. Culturally, demographically, it was a lot different from Jackson. I probably learned as much outside the classroom as I learned in the classroom. I mean, I learned about different ethnic groups and...
Yeah.
You know, I went to school with Jewish people and Italians, and mm-hmm. you know, I had gone to, I mean, I grew up in a Baptist, Southern Baptist household.
Right.
Went to Catholic schools, uh-huh. went to a Methodist college at Millsaps,
uh-huh.
and then I ended up at law school where we have Jewish holidays
wow.
off. So there was a lot of culture that was different from what I had been exposed to previously, and I think that helped me to grow a lot as a person outside the classroom. So being in upstate New York was a really good experience for me.
That's wonderful. What did you have to adjust to the cold weather?
I did. it was just very, I mean, there were times when we would go for 2 straight weeks and never get up to 32 degrees.
What?
So it was very
challenging, huh?
Yes. And I just kept telling myself, I'm from Mississippi. I don't have to live like this.
Why did you decide to come back to Mississippi to practice law?
I came back to Mississippi because, and it sounds really corny when you say it out loud, but I came back to Mississippi because I wanted to help people. And I wanted to help people in Mississippi. And so it was always my determination that no matter where I went for my education, I was going to come back to Mississippi to work and practice law. I think I always knew I wanted to help people, and I always saw politics as one avenue to do that. I don't know when I first decided that I wanted to be a judge. Yes. I just remember that a vacancy occurred on the circuit bench, and I remember watching the announcement about Justice Banks being appointed to the Supreme Court, and my thought was, wow, I wonder who's going to take his place.
Right.
And then I got some calls, and people suggested that I should be interested, and then I was interested, and I ended up being appointed by Governor Mabus as a circuit judge, and so I had to run for that seat, and so I was thrust into politics by virtue of the fact that being a circuit judge required that you run for the office.
Right. Okay. So what was it like when you first became a circuit court judge?
The first day?
Yes.
I was terrified. I had not gone to any judge school. I had not had any formal training or preparation to become a circuit judge.
Oh.
I mean, a judge, obviously, a circuit judge, obviously, is someone who is trained in the law. You have to be a licensed practicing attorney.
Right.
But the first day as a judge, you feel all of the responsibility for wanting to be right, to be correct, to do the right thing,
yes.
To make sure that you're reaching just and fair decisions,
yes.
While at the same time, it's your first day on the job, the same as it be the first day on the job for some guy going to the factory. And so you're nervous, you want to do well, you want to make a good impression.
Yeah.
It was frightening that first day.
Oh, wow.
But it was exciting.
When did you graduate from high school?
Graduated from what was then Sumner Hill High School in Clinton. It's now, I think, just a ninth grade center for the city of Clinton School District. But at the time, it was the high school for the county where African Americans went to school, because the school system up through 1970 was segregated. And so Sumner Hill High School was where African Americans in the county went to high school.
Okay.
Now, I actually lived through in high school the period where there was a desegregation order and the schools became integrated and all of that.
Oh, really?
And I was still in high school when all of that happened.
Oh, really?
So it was an interesting time to grow up, and Clinton, Mississippi was an interesting place to have grown up.
Well, I understand that you received some honors while you were in high school, right?
A few.
Yeah.
I was valedictorian of the class.
Okay.
I was star student because I had the highest ACT score and the highest grade point average. And I think at the time I made the highest ACT score that had ever been made at my school. But I'm sure that record's been broken 1,000 times since then, because that was a long time ago. But and so I had a few honors and awards over the course of my years in high school.
It was great. Well, did you have to study hard, or were you just naturally smart?
It's going to sound arrogant if I say I was just naturally smart. Frankly, in high school, I don't think I had to study hard, and I say that in comparison to the kind of studying I had to do at Millsaps.
Okay.
At Millsaps, I had to study hard in order to make decent grades and to get a degree from Millsaps College.
Yes.
High school wasn't that hard for me.
Okay.
I did well in high school, and I was typically able to do it. I mean, most of the time I could take study hall and do most of my work.
Oh,
so
that's good.
It wasn't that difficult for me. Okay. College, on the other hand, was a challenge.
What did you want to be when you grew up?
Well, you know, when I started Millsaps, and I chose Millsaps because they had the pre-engineering program. So I think by the time I was going to college, I decided I wanted to be an electrical engineer.
Okay.
Before that, growing up, I used to build things. I'd build benches and chairs, and so I would make stuff.
Uh-huh.
And so I thought I wanted to be a carpenter. So there was a period of time where I thought I wanted to be a carpenter.
Uh-huh.
Then it was electrical engineering. So, you know, I'm not sure at what point I decided that I wanted to go into law, but that's not something, I mean, I was out of college for a year and a half, 2 years before I started law school.
Oh.
So I didn't go immediately to law school, from college. So growing up, I mean, what I wanted to be, kind of evolved over the years.
Okay.
I just knew I didn't want to be poor.
Exactly.
So I wanted to have a job where I could make enough money to take care of myself and my family.
Right. Okay. Well that was a good goal. Tell me, did you have a nickname while you were growing up?
I certainly had a nickname while I was growing up, and my brothers and sisters still refer to me by that nickname.
Is that right?
And I am not about to share that nickname with you and your viewers here on the air.
Why not?
I'm not going to do that. You can't get it out of me.
Because are you afraid somebody might call you by that name?
People do call me by that name, the ones who know, but I'm not sharing it.
What is your favorite food?
That is very difficult to say. Food is something I'm very passionate about. I love to cook. I cook 3-4 times a week. I cook a huge meal every Sunday.
Is that right?
I love to cook. I have my own recipes, and so I can get very excited about cooking.
Tell me about one of your gourmet meals.
Well, I don't know that you would call them gourmet. For example, this past Sunday, I think I cooked cabbage greens on a bed of ground turkey. I made sweet potatoes. I made cornbread, and I don't use Jiffy Mix. It's cornbread from scratch.
No.
Cornbread, and then I had smothered turkey breast cutlets, gravy, and rice.
Oh, my goodness.
So that's a typical Sunday meal, and then I'll cook 3-4 times during the week if I have time to do that.
Really?
It's very relaxing for me. Cooking is like therapy for me.
Right.
I get in the kitchen, and I just relax.
So if you cook during the week, how long does it take you to throw something together?
I have a lot of recipes, my own recipes that are quick recipes. I can walk into the kitchen at 6 and have dinner on the table by 7:30.
Oh, really?
And sometimes faster than that, depending on what I'm preparing.
Oh, yeah?
Yes.
Well, can you fry chicken?
I do not fry chicken. I try to avoid fried foods as much as I can. I like fried foods.
Okay.
But I try to avoid cooking fried food because I figure I get enough fried foods by showing up in Kentucky Fried Chicken once a week to get my fix. So
okay.
I try to avoid doing that.
What is your favorite television show?
It's probably a really good football game.
Oh, really?
I like NFL football.
Okay.
I like pro basketball, although I don't really watch pro basketball much until the playoffs.
Okay.
And then I have, you know, you say my favorite shows. I'm trying to think of what shows that I try not to miss.
Okay.
Probably 24, although last season was not that great.
Okay.
And Girlfriends happens to be a show that I like.
Okay. So. Yeah, that's one of my favorites, too.
Yeah.
I understand that you have also lectured at Harvard.
Okay. Yes. Harvard has a child advocacy workshop for, previously it was just third year law students. This year they opened it up, this past school year they opened it up for second and third year law students, where they bring in lawyers and judges from all over the country to teach law students how to try lawsuits.
Okay.
And I've had the good fortune to be invited to Harvard to teach as a part of that program, for probably about 10 times over the past 10 years.
And what was that like being at Harvard?
At first, it was very intimidating.
Really?
Because I'm surrounded by lawyers and professors and judges who are very bright, very knowledgeable.
Well, so
and that's just the people I work with.
Yeah.
That's not counting the students who are very bright and very knowledgeable. So that kind of an academic, scholarly, learned environment can be very intimidating. And so it's exciting, it's stimulating, it compels you to read, to stay sharp, to keep current on what's happening in the profession, and it helps me to hone my skills.
Yes.
Your listening skills, your analytical skills, all of which serve you well as a judge.
Right. I also understand you have received a lot of awards over the years. Tell me about some of them.
Now that is very difficult for me to talk about. I've received a number of awards over the years. I think the one that means the most to me is I was awarded Parent of the Year by the Jackson Public School District in 2001.
Okay.
And I have received a lot of awards. That's probably the one that means the most to me.
Okay.
And then I came in second in the entire state of Mississippi for
wow.
Parent of the Year.
Really?
And that just meant a lot to me because it says that some other people thought that I was a good parent. And I just think that's a very important job. So it's nice to have someone say, I think you're doing it pretty well.
Oh, that is wonderful. Okay, so tell me about your children.
I have three sons.
Okay.
They're all here in Jackson.
Okay.
They're all adults, and they're all employed, so I'm very happy about that.
They're all employed,
yes.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Where do they work?
Well, two of my sons are lawyers and one is a banker.
Really?
Yes, and I'd be plugging their respective employers if I said where they work, but I will tell you that two are lawyers and one's a banker, and they're all here in town.
You have done a fantastic job.
Well, thank you very much.
Well, you know what? You wear so many hats, and you wear them well.
Thank you.
Well, that wraps up today's show. Thank you for watching.
It's like you're looking through a telescope. You see where you're going to be. Growing, getting better. You're not the person they see. Can't be mad at the things you've been through, because they built your muscle. Now you're stronger than you've ever been. They can't stop.